بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. جزاكم الله خيرا for joining us again on our third episode on the month of Ramadan. الحمد لله. Previously we have spoken about what is the month of Ramadan, and we have also spoken about the virtues of the month of Ramadan and fasting in it. Today inshallah our goal is going to be to discuss the things that are going to damage the month of Ramadan for us. When it comes to things that damage the month of Ramadan, they are divided into two. There are some things that will completely ruin the month of Ramadan for us, or the days of fasting in them. And there are some things that will completely minimize the reward that we would be able to attain. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us in the Quran, وَحِلَّ لَكُمْ لَيْلَةَ الصِّيَامِ الرَّفَثُ إِلَىٰ نِسَائِكُمْ هُنَّ لِبَاسٌ لَكُمْ أَنْتُمْ لِبَاسٌ لَهُنْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us during the nights of the month of Ramadan, it is allowed for you to go and be with your wives. It is allowed for you to go be with your husband. Now what does this mean? It means that during the night time, after Maghrib, until the time that you start fasting, having relations with your wife, this is something that is allowed, or having relations with your husband, this is something that is allowed, and it will not affect your Ramadan. But doing it during the day, it will complete your Ramadan. It will completely destroy that day of Ramadan for you. And it will be as if you did not fast that day, because you have broken your fasting on that day by going and having relations with your husband or going and having relations with your wife. Now, at the end of this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He also tells us, وَكُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا, eat and drink, حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضِ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us to continue drinking and eating until the black line becomes apparent to you from the white line in the horizon. Then, ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. From that point on, then continue your fasting until the night time comes, until the sun sets, and it is time for Maghrib and for you to break your fast. So from this one ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us three things. He tells us that during the night time, we are allowed to go and be with our partners, with our spouses. And He also tells us during the night time, it is allowed for us to eat and drink. To eat, and then the third being to drink. But during the day of Ramadan, these are things that we are not able to do. So doing any of these three during the day will completely break your fast. To the point where now you have to make up this day that you have missed. And some of the scholars are of the opinion that you are not even able to make it up. That even if you were to pay what you are required to, or if you were to pay fast another day, it will not be a makeup that is going to be rewarded, but rather just a makeup so that you are not considered from those that did not fast on this day. So this is one type of things that will break your fast. Now when it comes to the second one, the second category of things that we do, that we indulge in, things that we are heedless of, these are not things that will necessarily break your fast, but it will ensure that you will not benefit from the month of Ramadan. And when the end of Ramadan comes, you will not be from those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so that you may attain taqwa. Now, what are these things? We know the famous hadith, the hadith Qudsi, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, whoever does not leave off قَوْلَ الزُّورِ, the false statements, or any type of speech, any type of actions that are haram, saying things that are taking the people away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, anyone that does not leave this off and acting on them, implementing them in their lives, there is no need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for you to leave off your drinking, your eating, and your desires. So this is the first thing. It might not completely break your fast, but it will ensure that you are not getting the benefits of the month of Ramadan. You are not someone that is fulfilling the rights that Ramadan has upon us, the fasting in the month of Ramadan has upon us. Now this is one. The other thing that you see, especially from the people that are of, you know, younger when it comes to their age, it is that they will spend their entire day sleeping. They will go to sleep after Fajr, maybe wake up for Salatul Dhuhr, they'll pray Salatul Dhuhr and go to sleep. And they'll sleep until it's time for Iftar. And then they will get up and they will have their Iftar. And then they will spend the whole night staying up. And then when it's time for Fajr, they'll have their suhoor. Sometimes before Fajr, before even praying the Salah, they'll go to sleep. For someone that spends the whole month of Ramadan like this, they will not be able to attain the taqwa that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised the people that will be fasting. And another thing, anyone that spends the whole day wasting their time, whether it is on social media, whether it is on watching television, whether it is on just playing, or whether it is in gatherings that there are no benefits in, this will not break your fast, but it will ensure that you are losing the reward and the benefits that you would be getting if you had spent your time in a better manner. Anyone that is doing things that will not benefit him, that are not getting him closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this month of Ramadan, you are truly going to miss it. And why should we even fear missing the month of Ramadan, when for many of us it continues to come over and over and over? It continues to happen. We have been alive 18 years, 19, 20, 50, 60, and Ramadan continues to come. So why should we even worry about wasting this one when we can do better next year? The reason why we should fear, it is because of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that is authentically reported, that he was climbing the minbar, and while he was ascending the minbar, every step that he would take, and as we know it had three steps, he would say Ameen. He would say Ameen, Ameen. So three times. Then the companions, they asked him after, "We saw something strange from you. We saw you going up and saying Ameen, Ameen, Ameen." And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he explains to them and he says, "Jibril alayhi salam came to me and he was making dua." And before we continue, let's pause here and think about this. This is Jibril alayhi salam, the greatest of the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that is responsible for the wahi, Ruhul Ameen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way that he describes him in the Quran, the one that is sent to every single messenger with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The messenger from the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the one that is making dua. And we know that he is someone that is not making sins, someone that is disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but someone that is obeying every single command that is coming from his Lord. Now you have him making the dua. And who is the one that is saying Ameen to the dua that he is making? It is our Prophet, salawatu Rabbi wa salamu alayhi. Our Prophet that we love more than we love our own parents, more than we love our own children, and more than we love our own selves. The one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes in the Quran, إِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ, that you are from the best of characters when it comes to the manners. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us he has chosen him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us all of the things he tells us about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the chosen one, the master from the children of Bani Adam, the one that is going to be resurrected first on the Day of Judgment, the one in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Allah has taken me as a Khalil, just like he has taken Ibrahim alayhi salam as a Khalil, the one that is going to have the ability to do shafa'ah or intercede for all of mankind on the Day of Judgment. We can go on and on the virtues of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but I believe that you and I know enough to know who he is. And as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam tells us in an authentic hadith, أَمَا إِنِّي أَعْلَمُكُمْ بِاللَّهِ وَأَخْشَاكُمْ لِلَّهِ, I am the one that knows the most about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also the one that fears him the most. So the one that fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most is saying Ameen to the dua. And what is one of the du'as that Jibreel alayhi salam makes when he is climbing the minbar? He says, رَغِمَ أَنْفٌ, or may his nose be dragged. And who is he talking about? The one that reaches the month of Ramadan and through it he is not forgiven. Through the things that he does in Ramadan, he does not attain the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is why we should be worried when we are not taking advantage of the month of Ramadan. Why we should be worried when we are not doing the things that we should be doing. It is not about what Ramadan are we going to reach. Imagine we did not take advantage of a Ramadan that came previously, and we are from those that Jibreel alayhi salam made dua against, that we'd be from the people that their faces are going to be humiliated on the Day of Judgment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from this fate. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst the people that benefit from the month of Ramadan, and they do not engage in things that will ruin their Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from the people of taqwa. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.